Good evening. Is this thing even on? It's kind of on. Hello. Hello, hello. To those of you in the back, I think we're going to get started rather soon. Basically now. Given that it's 7:15 and we wanted to start at 7. Hi, I'm Felix. I'm one of the co-organizers of this meetup. I want to thank you all for coming. I also want to thank you all for RSVPing correctly, which is always fantastic. Also want to thank all of those who said no and didn't show up. That's also always great. It's like, if you organize one of these things, it's like straight up terrifying to like have a bunch of people RSVP and then wonder if you're going to have enough space. It's literally the worst thing. Like, my biggest fear is I stay up at night, I'm really afraid that we're going to do this and then 500 people are going to show up. They're going to trash the whole place. And Microsoft bills me for all the damage. That would be like the worst part. Anyway, obviously the emergency exits are to your left over there. So if there's like a sudden fire, please just leave the building. And the restrooms are on the other side to the left in the hallway. We have three speakers today. First up is Jacob Groundwater, manager of Electron, and all around great human being. So give it up for Jacob.
Hello. Hey, everyone. It definitely doesn't sound like this is on, but it's good. You can hear me at the back? All right, cool. Hello. So, yeah, my name's Jacob. I'm just going to give a quick kind of what's up with Electron. I don't have pretty slides. This was going to be like a 5-10-minute talk. I will say that we do have two really awesome talks coming up, and there's this totally empty front row here that's super intimidating to look at. If anyone from the back or the middle wanted to like come hang out here, that's cool. It would like make this place a little more cozy. Okay, so let me give you the history of how I got into Electron. So I started at GitHub around November, and I started as the manager for the Electron team. Up until that point, Electron kind of shared a manager with the Atom team, and Electron as a project kind of shared a lot of its existence with Atom. And one thing that I wanted to talk about is one of the big changes that's happened is Electron is really a standalone project today. Electron is got its own team, its own manager, its own product management people. Atom is a very important constituent along with Slack and Microsoft and many others. But also, if you're developing apps with Electron, we really want you to know that, like, for us, this is a first-class project. It's a first-class platform, something you should feel confident in, like, building your app, building your business, building your technologies on top of. Another thing we've started doing recently is we're trying to formalize, you know, how our team interacts with the community. So this could be anything from making sure your bug reports get addressed in a timely manner, to getting pull requests in, to just getting input on the direction that you would like to see Electron go. And you know, it's never a guarantee that we might put our own developers on it, but there's a lot of cases where you might want something out of the project, and if you're willing to maybe put one person on doing the work, a couple weeks, month or so, that could get into the project. So rather than maybe having to go out on your own and build essentially the equivalent project that you have total control over, we want you to know we really want to have these conversations with you. So if you want to talk about the direction, engage us. So right now, I would say a good place is through our issue tracker. Maybe in the next couple months, we're going to have a much better process. We're working on things like RFC processes. So if you want to make a formal proposal, you can do that. We're letting the right now we're kind of letting the cow path settle for that. So we've been working with the current maintainers on setting this up. There's also other things coming up. I'm going to just spill the beans on this. We're talking about an actual Electron conference coming up. So if you have a talk, if you're working, we want to hear from big app developers. We want to hear from small app developers. We want to hear from module authors. We want to hear from people doing maybe something we hadn't thought of. So all that will be coming out of the pipe soon. I feel extremely lucky to be working on a project like this. I almost can't believe that I got the opportunity to. It's so big already. There's so many cool things this, like, these meetups, people are super interested in the project. I thought one thing I could do is just, like, answer a few questions if people had them right now. So let's kind of open it up. Anyone have a question that you might want to ask? Say it one more time. So the question was, what are our goals for the next year with Electron? So one thing that I've been trying to be clear with people who are participating in the community is there are both project goals, for example, where like what Electron would like to see, but there's also some GitHub specific goals. So why that's important is the project might do some things that maybe GitHub didn't put a developer on, but it's still totally possible for another group to come together and get the project going in that direction. I'll give you the three high-level ones that we're interested in. One is we're really interested in maintaining and improving the core experience. So stability, security, you know, the size of an Electron app can get bulky. We want to reduce that, the memory it takes up, making sure we're up to date with Chromium. There's a lot of security patches that are in there that we want to make sure we're getting merged in. You should kind of just be inheriting these for free as you're an app developer. So you're just kind of pulling in the latest Electron. We've done an update to Chromium. Google has put a bunch of great engineers on maybe making GC improvements there, and you kind of get those for free. So that's one thing. Another thing we're looking at is the community. So I'm calling this reach, and what I really mean is, like, right now Electron is accessible to a certain group of people. Maybe they're developers in the Bay Area, but if they're not developers in the Bay Area, it might be a little more difficult. We want to improve that, and that's around the globe. If I look at who's coming to our site, it's almost uniformly distributed across the world. That's something that I haven't seen in a lot of sites, so that's exciting to me. I want to make sure that we're getting to those folks. That might involve like different languages. That might involve making sure that CDNs, something like that. I don't know. And the last thing is kind of room for some experiments, room to have some fun. Like these are all unexpected things, so I can't say them right now. I want to give people the chance to kind of challenge what Electron is and where it might go. So how's that for an answer? Cool. Any other questions? This was great. This is a good kickoff. Silence. Felix, do you have a question? Sure. So one thing that would be great to find out from people who are brand new is, what are the hardest parts for you coming to Electron? That's something that maybe you experience it and you go, well, this was very difficult for me, but I went on this issue tracker and then I went on Stack Overflow and eventually I figured it out. That's great. But, you know, you've probably got a lot of experience going into new territory. So if we can make that experience easier for someone, that increases the accessibility of the project. So folks who are new, love to hear your feedback. If you want, if you're using the documentation, you find a piece that, like, you know, didn't quite jive with what you were thinking, you're like, oh, this was poorly worded. We love pull requests. If a pull request is a little too intimidating, we love issues. If that's too intimidating, like, there's probably other ways to get in touch with us. You could even find me or Kevin or Paul, who are kind of standing, hanging out at the back. Paul is waving. Just come up and say, hey, I found this thing. I'm not really into the whole GitHub issues thing yet. We want to make sure that this project is accessible to people who want to give it a shot. Any more? Yeah, at the back. Lots of hopes. So the question was, any hopes of Electron for mobile? So There's a few. It's mostly, I would say, I'm not the expert in this area, but it's mostly a technical limitation at this point. For example, I think iOS doesn't let you, you might have ventured down this road, you can't put anything that does its own interpretation or execution of like another language onto iOS, I believe. They just won't let you embed Chromium or V8 or something like that, basically. If you can figure it out, I will merge it. You know, there might be other hopes too, like if Electron has an API that gets duplicated in something that already works in mobile, you know, that increases the ability for you to maybe not take the app exactly is, but maybe a large portion of it and move it across. So if you have, I would say that there's a lot of hope, but that is a difficult one to attack. So I would like to make progress in that area, but I don't think it's going to happen in the next like year, I would say. Sorry. Any other questions? Super quiet. Okay. Well, thank you very much. Come say hi. My name's Jacob. Usually pretty friendly. I'm Canadian, so they say we're friendly. Anyway, Felix, thank you.
Thanks, Jacob. Okay. Next up is Ben, who's been in the Electron community for, I feel like, forever, which I think is appropriate. This is Ben, right here. He's also using one of the later MacBooks, meaning that we now have to find a dongle. Because that's how MacBooks work these days. All right. Check, check, check. Well, Ben is setting up. I can. We tried like super hard to play with, but an open source group I was working with. We tried super hard to think about how we could take Electron Mobile, and it comes down to like a bunch of core issues. The biggest one being that anything that roughly resembles Node on mobile is either very slow, or straight up not allowed. Like the second one is the bigger issue than the first one. There have been a few attempts by other companies. Most of them are now bankrupt for probably. You know, the reason that you can't really, like, you got to jailbreak your phone, and it's all pretty terrible. And the other one is what Jacob briefly hinted upon, this whole thing where you maybe replicate the API. So let's say you have something in Electron, like the user profile API or get known folders or something. You could, in theory, replicate that with something like Cordova, but every single time you try anything like that, you very quickly realize that every single application you could theoretically build with that kind of sucks. Right, and I'm at least very proud that Electron and as a community has so far built pretty high quality applications, right? Like Atom, Visual Studio Code, Slack. Those are all apps that kind of don't suck. And doing the same with web apps on mobile is still pretty darn hard, especially if you consider that, like, you know, most people still have like Android 2, which is now like 10 years old. So, anyway. Well, Ben, take it away.
Cool. Is this working? I don't know if this is closer. Hello? Hello? Is that? That? Can everybody hear me? I can also just talk super loud. That's cool with me. You know what? I'll just use this instead.
All right. Cool. So hey guys, my name's Ben Gotow. I think I've had the pleasure of meeting a bunch of you in the past, but if not, welcome to the Electron community. I've been working with Electron for a long time. I actually have spent the majority of the last 2 years working on a mail client called Nihilus N1, and we actually like forked Atom back when Atom shell was kind of like buried in there, and ripped out everything that made it a text editor and turned it into a mail client. And so in doing that, I've learned a lot about different ways that you can store data in an Electron app. And this is a pretty common question that shows up on the community Slack channels and in the mailing lists and stuff. A lot of people wondering, like, how do I use SQLite in my Electron app? Or how do I do this other, you know, how do I, like, store a bunch of objects? And so I wanted to kind of take 15 or 20 minutes and give you guys an overview of different options that you have for doing that in Electron. And at the end, we'll talk about a new ORM that we developed as part of my work at Nihilus to store tons and tons of mail data in Electron. Cool. So for the purposes of this talk, we're going to pretend that we want to build a clone of Evernote with Electron. So the question is, you know, we can create like a stock Electron app, and we can use React or something like that for our UI. It might come out looking something like this. This can be our notes application. So let's just imagine that in the left sidebar, I want to have like a list of all my notes. And I want to have like a search bar at the top that lets me type in a, you know, a word that appears somewhere in one of these notes and pull it up. And I want to have like the section down at the bottom that shows my recent notes. So like the last two or three that I've edited. And we can use like, you know, Chromium's content editable or something like that to make this text area pretty easily, actually. So the question is, how should we store all of this data? So the first thing to think about is, do I actually need a database at all? You know, if you're coming from the server-side Node.js world, a lot of the time it's natural to jump immediately to a database because, you know, if you're spinning up and down EC2 instances, like connecting to a database is pretty much your only option to store stuff. That's really not the case in Electron. You have to remember that you're targeting, you know, you're writing software for something that will only be dealing with one user's data and has access to a persistent file system. And so for really small data sets, you know, if you're imagining something that's like less than 1,000 objects that are pretty small, honestly, just like throwing the entire collection in a single JSON array and filtering it in memory will probably work and will probably be great. It might even be faster than, you know, taking a string, having SQLite like parse that into a statement, executing the statement, turning the result back into V8 objects. Sometimes just like throwing it all in a giant array is totally fine. So let's say that we've decided that, you know, we're going to have more than 1,000 items, or we need to be able to kind of query this data in interesting ways. We want to have a database. So the next question to sort of ask ourselves as we think through this is, do I need a relational database? Chromium actually has some really great built-in options for doing key value storage. And so, you know, if you imagine that our notes application is going to stay simple forever, we can imagine doing something like this, where I have this like key value storage, and each note or each document has a key. And in the value field, I just like store the JSON that represents that note. And then I have a couple of indexes that I need, like the one for that recent notes sidebar. But instead of, you know, firing up like SQLite and being able to build like arbitrary queries across arbitrary columns, I can actually just pre-compute like this recent IDs array. And, you know, when a new note gets saved, I'll just like update this little array, and that's all I need to do that one query for the sidebar, essentially. And so I can pretty much call it a day. So if you're using Chromium, there are a couple of options for key value storage. These are actually both built into newer versions of Chrome, and also Safari and Firefox, and pretty much all like web standard compliant browsers. So IndexedDB is the more powerful one that you'll see like a lot of wrappers around. It has synchronous and asynchronous APIs. You can store like JSON blobs. It kind of works like MongoDB, where you can like retrieve a specific key, or you can retrieve everything with like a key prefix. So you can essentially retrieve like a range of objects. It also supports indexes, and in Electron, an IndexedDB can take up 1/3 of your free disk space, or the user's free disk space, rather. Which could, you know, probably be several gigabytes under most circumstances. The other option here is local storage. People use local storage a lot in Electron apps for like persisting user settings. You know, if you just need to store like a tiny little blob of data with like the user's selection or the path that they were looking at on the file system when they quit the app or something like that. The API is 100% synchronous and only stores strings, only retrieves specific keys, and you can only stick 10 megabytes worth of data in there. There's actually an open GitHub issue on the Electron repo. That restriction might be raised in the near future. The other thing that I sort of hinted at earlier is that the file system is actually like a really fantastic key value store. Depending on kind of the needs of your application, it might be totally legit to just save everything in a directory or in a directory tree somewhere on disk. We've actually like done this a whole bunch for different kinds of data while working on the Nihilist mail client. And it's actually super great because somebody can like symlink that directory to Dropbox and your like product support sharing immediately. So there can be some like really fun pros to using the file system, even if it has like a couple of downsides. So let's say that we think about all these things. We have a pondering emoji face. But we decide at the end of the day that we really need a relational database. You know, we want to do full text search, or we have like a pretty complex schema and we want to be able to query across like different fields and do sorting and ordering and stuff like that. And maybe we want to have like a million rows. Or, you know, in the case of the Nihilist mail client I worked on, like 4 gigabytes of mail data. So in this case, SQLite is absolutely the de facto standard for doing this in client-side applications. Pretty much like every Mac app that uses structured data uses core data, which is built on top of SQLite. iOS and Android both include copies of SQLite built in, so you can use it there. The big reason that SQLite is so popular is that it builds on basically every platform imaginable. It's all written in like really straightforward C, and it has no external dependencies. So whereas like installing MySQL or like shipping MySQL inside of your Electron app would introduce all sorts of problems and issues for random Windows users. Sorry, Felix. Shipping SQLite is super easy. It's also open source and has super great docs. The list goes on and on. So if you start looking at using SQLite in your Electron app, your next step will probably be looking for an ORM to use with it. So an ORM essentially sits on top of the actual like SQLite C bindings for Node, and it allows you to construct queries using a higher level JavaScript syntax and work with models and kind of have nice abstractions and stuff. SQLize is a really great one that I personally like. There's also one called bookshelf.js. And depending on the other platforms and languages that you're comfortable with, one of these will probably seem more familiar to you. If you're coming from like the active record world, SQLize is great. But there are some issues. Most JavaScript database wrappers were built with server-side Node.js in mind, which means that they have a really heavy focus on querying. They have great query interfaces. They have a lot of advanced options for things like connection pools and migrations. But they have really limited APIs for connecting models to views. And so I was actually an iOS developer before I started working with Electron and like diving into all this JavaScript stuff. And basically, what we were trying to do was say, give me the notes matching this query, and let me know if the results change so that I can like update my view. And if you're coming from another platform that has like ORMs and database layers built for client-side apps, there's almost always a construct for doing this. And so in core data, there's this thing called NS fetch results controller, where you essentially like bind a query to it, and then it just like emits events when stuff changes. On Android, there's a very similar concept with view cursors. And so when we started work on this mail client a couple of years ago, we set out to build our own layer on top of SQLite that would essentially do just this. And so this is Electron RxDB. Electron RxDB is an observable object store built on top of SQLite. It's essentially core data for Electron apps. And it was originally built to power the Nihilus N1 mail client. And because like we pushed it pretty hard with all kinds of mail data, it's actually been tuned fairly well. And so the next thing I want to do is just take a little bit of a dive into this and show you what it actually looks like to try and implement our Notes app. So the first thing we're going to do is define a note class. And so if you're familiar with SQLize or another ORM, this probably looks pretty familiar. Essentially, the idea is we create a new ES6 JavaScript class that extends kind of the RxDB base class. And we give it a static attributes list. You can see here we've got like a string and a date time field. This queryable property basically tells the ORM that we want to create indexes on that field. And once we've done this in our code, we can instantiate a new one of those things and persist it to the database inside of a transaction. And then later down the road, if we want to pull a bunch of them out, we can use sort of an active record style syntax to construct a database query and execute it. So this right here is a JavaScript promise syntax. So it's essentially going to perform that database query asynchronously in SQLite and then give us a bunch of notes back. So this is pretty cool and also pretty typical. SQLize or bookshelf.js would do something really similar. But this is where it gets fun. So let's imagine that we're using React for our little notes app. Somewhere we have a container component that's basically wrapping our sidebar. And our sidebar is going to show all of the notes ordered by some field. And so essentially what we're going to do with RxDB here is in our component did mount, when we're setting up that view, we're going to construct a query and then grab an observable from it and subscribe to that observable. And whenever we get new items, we're just going to call setState and React will re-render that stuff for us. And so this is really great because somewhere else in our code, we can do that block that we just saw and essentially save a new note. And RxDB will automatically broadcast those changes to our observable up there and update the notes view. And so this library, RxDB, is essentially the marriage of SQLite and RxJS, which is a really popular library in JavaScript for doing observables. If you're not familiar with observables, the idea is essentially that we bind to some object that emits events, and we say whenever new data is available, like send it down this chain of functions. It's kind of like a JavaScript promise, except that the promise fires over and over and over again as new data is received. So in this RxDB library, the database is actually an event emitter. And so whenever we go and save an object, an event is emitted that tells us exactly what changed and how it changed. And that allows us to do some really cool stuff. We can essentially write these observable queries that look at what's being changed and say, will that impact the results that I previously gave to the UI? And if it does, like let me tweak those results and send them again. Or, you know, in a worst case scenario, like if you do something that alters like an order field or delete an object, it might actually rerun a database query and send new results to the UI afterwards. So like I mentioned before, we use this in the Nihilus N1 mail client a whole lot. This kind of has been pulled out of the internals of the mail client. RxDB provides live slices of gigabytes and gigabytes of mail data in the app. The way we've sort of architected things, the views in the application bind to Flux Redux stores to get application state, and they bind to RxDB queries to get application data. And this is like a really convenient pattern to use if you happen to have more data than you could like store in, you know, your little global Redux JavaScript object. The other convenient thing about sort of using this RxDB database as the source of truth for data is that many of the features that we built, like mail rules, notifications, things like that, can actually be implemented with database listeners and isolated into their own little containers. So essentially, like, mail rules are queries on data. And so we just say, hey, well, like, whenever anything new matches this query, like, run this mail rule action. And so that's pretty cool. So the other nice thing is that this RxDB library has basically been built specifically for front-end JavaScript applications, specifically for Electron. So it has multiple window support right out of the box. If you like save an object in one window and have a query subscribing to it in a different window, we will automatically bridge the event across so that your other view updates. The library itself builds SQLite for Electron and makes sure that you have the right node settings configured. This is actually, unfortunately, like sort of a pain. A lot of the time, SQLite will be like the very first node module that you're using that has to build native code, which means that you have to set some environment variables correctly or use a project like Electron Rebuild to get it working. So we kind of take that into account. And it also comes with this Notes app as a working example. So at this point, I'd love to answer any questions you guys have. You can check out the source to this library at that URL, and I'll publish the slides on Twitter. Any questions? Yeah. Yeah. So the question was, how does this library know when something in the database changed? Does it pull SQLite or do something more sophisticated? Essentially, what there's sort of always a trade-off. Basically, the way Electron RxDB works, it tightly constrains the ways that you can save objects. So like one of the big issues is that if you were able to write a query that said, like, update notes where, you know, unread equals false, unread equals true, you could essentially perform a change to the database that had unknown impact, which would mean that, like, we would have no choice but to rerun every query that was, like, powering parts of your UI. And so the way that we went for this library was basically to restrict the number of ways in which you can save things so that we can always observe like what the before state was and what the after state was, and compute what views would be impacted. So yeah, does that sort of answer the question? Any other questions? Yeah. Yep. So that doesn't require any interaction with the RxJS scheduler. Essentially, what happens is when the database emits an event in one window, we basically just have an event listener that captures that event and sends it over Electron's IPC APIs, and then refires that event in the other window. So the events aren't synchronized in any way, and you know it might be slightly delayed, but should create the same result. Cool. Well, thanks, guys. I appreciate it.
Sweet. Thank you. Actually, I'm up next. Sorry. I'm going to be a last speaker.
Should I do your intro?
No, I think it's all right. I'm going to do my own intro. I can do that. Let me just quickly set up here for a second.
That's not okay. Quick check in the back. Can you guys hear me? No.
Can you guys hear me now? Is this better? Sort of. Just going to do the whole talk like this, which is going to be great.
All right.
Anyway, just to quickly say hi while I'm like digging up the slides here. I'm Felix. I work at Slack. I'm one of the people who built the Slack desktop app, which you may have known is based on Electron. I really like doing this, so I'm just going to do it. How many people here are using Slack? Yes. Oh my god, this feels so good. You have no idea. Makes me always very happy. All right, so one of the things I wanted to talk about, or specifically the thing I'm going to talk about today, is that Google's two-factor authentication is very annoying. Sorry. Anyway, I will today actually talk about Windows. I realized the great irony of talking about Windows from a Mac. I'm sorry about that. We really wanted to buy new computers, but then CES came around, and they announced a bunch of like really sweet machines, and we were like, maybe we should wait. There we go. All right. Google, you can do this. There we go. All right. So I'm going to talk about Windows. The reason I'm going to talk about Windows, mostly, is that many of us run Macs. I think that's sort of what the state of the world is, especially in San Francisco and the Bay Area. Again, quick show of hands. Who's not running a Mac as the main driver? Cool. Yes, four people. Amazing. Well, then you too would be in the category of people who don't intimately know the Windows runtime. The greater point here is that before I even start with this, there's a number of people out there who are still running Windows. When I prepared this presentation, I was thinking about enterprises, people who are invested in VR, people who care about 3D printing or scanning, people who care about IoT. But apparently now it's also people who care about having an HDMI port or having a USB port. You know, those things. And I, for instance, I did like this tour through the Tesla factory, and I found it quite surprising and interesting how like every single machine is still a Windows machine. And I think it's not because Tesla doesn't have the money, it's not because Tesla doesn't have people that are smart enough, it's because they have needs that are currently not served by Macs. And I think, especially in the Electron community, it's quite interesting how we are all running Macs, and we sort of jump at the very first, like I feel like every single developer I talk to has some plan for the touch bar, us included. We also have thought extensively about the touch bar. And that makes sense because we use Macs, we run Macs, we have that thing right in front of us, but it's quite likely that the majority of our users are probably not running Macs, and we should think about what their experience is. So I wanted to give this like very quick one-on-one primer on how to do stuff in Windows for Mac developers who usually build cross-platform Electron apps, but they like put all the bells and whistles in for Mac and then sort of forget about like everything else that is there. Quick heads up, Windows in 2017 might not exactly be the Windows that you remember. If the last Windows you used was something like Windows 7 or whatever, you're not completely up to date. And the biggest reason I believe to know that most Electron devs are not really up to date with what Windows is doing these days is, for instance, the Electron user interface. You may have seen the default browser window on Windows. It has like this little gray bar at the top with a menu. Can I get a quick nod from people who know what I'm talking about? It's like this window menu. That has been like officially out of date with Windows 98. Right? Like think about the first iPhone and its like user interface. The default Windows user experience for Electron users is like a couple of years older than that. If you're building a Windows app in 2017, you would probably use something called UWP, the Universal Windows App. It runs on like HoloLens and Xbox, and it's like all this stuff. Most people tend to not do that, including Slack, because
we want to build one application that is great for all platforms. And the best way for us to do that is to build one amazing cross-platform app, right? However, UWP calls into something called the Windows Runtime, usually just called WinRT. And WinRT contains like all the fancy stuff that you would want to use. So if I'm talking about how to do Windows stuff from Electron, I'm really talking about how to do WinRT stuff from Electron, which is shockingly easy these days. So, Jesus, Google Slides is slow. Anyway, the Windows Runtime contains a whole bunch of interesting stuff that you can't do from Electron itself. You need to pull in the Windows Runtime, and those are usually things that are, I want to say, a little bit more heavy or just a little bit more integrated with the operating system. Like a typical example would be contacts, right? Let's say you're building your Evernote app and you want to like have a little ad selector. When you type an ad, you can select people. If that is supposed to integrate with the operating system's contacts menu, you need to talk to the contacts. If you want to do something really cool and talk to hardware, payment hardware, Bluetooth devices, if you want to build a freaking flashlight app in Electron, right? That's something you could do. The more primitive approach would probably be to just leave the screen white. That said, Windows has an API for that, right? You can just like activate it. You can just activate the flashlight if the device has one. So all of this stuff is in there. And I want to just very, this is going to be surprisingly easy. Accessing all of this stuff can be done the same way and can be done completely from Node without really touching C++. And the reason for that is that, conveniently, Electron is based on Node.js in parts, like many of you probably know. And Node has this concept of native add-ons, which are basically just allow you to build interfaces between JavaScript and C++. Right? You do like this thing where you walk in both worlds. And for most people, that means, usually, building stuff in C++. Ben talked about SQLite, which is wicked fast, so much faster than anything you can do in JavaScript, because it is built in C++. It's native. And whenever you do anything in SQLite, SQLite just accepts the command, then does everything it needs to do natively, and then returns a thing again as like a JavaScript object that you can work with. And Microsoft recently released something called Modern C++, which they actually got the domain for, which I think is very impressive. But behind Modern C++ is just like WinRT header files for C++, which you don't really have to worry about. Like none of this requires you to actually write C++. But what it means that what you could build was Node.rt, which is a collection of binaries and libraries that interface into the Windows runtime, as long as you're running on Windows. It's pretty cool. So basically, Windows is sort of organized like every other operating system you have ever seen. There's a bunch of namespaces. You can use those namespaces, and you can do stuff in them. So for instance, if you want to turn on the flashlight that I've talked about, there's like windows.devices. And inside windows.devices, there's like a method that is called enumerate devices. You would go through it until you find a flashlight, and if so, like turn it on. Right? Pretty straightforward stuff. So what you can do with Node.rt, you can just like go straight ahead and start requiring those modules. What you're seeing right now here is, what am I even showing you? Right, the lock screen. This is how to set the background image for a lock screen in C Sharp. This is the way Microsoft would want you to do this, ideally from a UWP app that you put in the Windows Store. And just briefly note the following things. We're requiring windows.storage. We're using windows.systemUserProfile. And then we have this await thing here, which is just a future, asynchronous, promise, whatever you want to call it, depending on where you come from. It's just a future. So we're getting this file asynchronously, any given path. And if the file was actually returned, we set the lock screen image. Pretty straightforward stuff, right? So what I'm not going to show you how to do this in C++, because it's very annoying. For those of you who do anything in C++, just like getting an image as a buffer by itself. Right, you gotta like allocate memory. You gotta make sure that it's yours. And you gotta like deselect. It's pretty annoying. The way you do that in Node.js using Node.rt is like this: you just require the same things, right? Which is pretty cool. You require the same things, and then you do the same methods. I personally am tremendously annoyed that we're still using Node.js callbacks, but that's what it is. You can turn those into promises if you feel like it. But essentially, the same thing is happening here, right? We're just doing like get file async. Those are all the same methods. And everything in between is completely abstracted away for you. It's super convenient. And we, for instance, in the Slack code base sort of use this stuff all over the place. What we started doing is we started sending notifications using node.rt. We had like this sort of hodgepodge of pretty annoying stuff before. Any C-sharp developers here? Anybody who has ever touched C-sharp? All right, cool. Doesn't matter. If you didn't know, there's a way to call C-sharp from Node.js. It involves like compiling it on the fly. So you basically, you do like this IKEA thing where you package your application up with a bit of source code and you send the whole thing to the user, and then you really hope that it compiles like on the target machine. It's called Edge.js. Its tagline is literally, if you have this problem, this solves your problem. You might be surprised to hear that this doesn't work all the time. Sometimes it doesn't compile, and then things just start breaking apart left and right. So if you use WinRT, you really have this amazing benefit of, you know, not having to compile things on the target machine, on your user's machine, because, you know, Windows is already there. It's quite convenient. Let me actually show you some of this in action. I was thinking very long and hard about the coolest library to demo. I literally made this presentation about like 5 minutes before this meetup because I spent all of the weekend looking at cool Windows APIs. And I think I came up with something that is rather interesting, which is called face detection, which is kind of cool, local face detection. Windows can do all kinds of stuff today. It's like crazy. You can just give Windows like a video and be like, tell me when the faces show up, and it does. It's not really what you expect, right? It's like crazy. If you didn't know, there's an API in there to talk to fridges and like TVs. It's called AllJoin, which is made by the Linux Foundation. It's part of the Windows kernel. It's crazy. I really tried very hard to get like a connected fridge here just for the demo. Didn't work out. So yeah. Let me just show you some real code so this all makes more sense. In particular, that's even the right thing? Yes, this is the right thing. So let's say you want to build like this thing, which I actually ended up building yesterday, called Electron Windows Face Detection, or actually Electron Face Detection Windows. And let me briefly walk you through how you would do face detection in like as few lines of code as possible. And there's basically three steps to doing face detection in Windows. And this is sort of the same, like the pattern here is the same no matter what you do. Like if you were to turn on the flashlight, if you were to enumerate devices, if you were to like interact with Xbox, whatever, this is sort of always the same pattern. I'm hoping that a pattern is going to become clear here, which is that you acquire a thing, you instantiate it, then you try to do a method on it, it's going to be asynchronous, you get like the operation back, and then you continue doing stuff with it. So let me make this a little bit bigger. In the case of getting faces, what you do is, step one, you decide on a path to your file. Quite crucial, that is left up to you. You're going to find an image, it's got to be there, it's important. Ideally, it has faces in it. Otherwise the whole, you know, it's like, it works, it's just going to tell you there's no faces in it. What you do is you get the file stream, which is really just you get a stream of the file. Annoyingly, again, because we're living in two worlds here, we're living in the C++ in the native Windows world and in the Node world, the file stream we have in C++ isn't really the same thing. It's like an iRandom access stream. It's a little bit different. One thing that is very convenient, though, is that as soon as you're handling a reference, you don't really have to worry about it. If you want to convert it, node.rt does that for you, which is cool. But just so you be aware, if you just like have a stream and give it to Windows, Windows is going to be like, this is just ones and zeros. I have no idea what you're talking about. So you get the file stream. Then you get the file stream, which, you know, even for Windows, still just like memory. You take that memory and turn that into a software bitmap, which is Windows' version of, this is an image. I know it has colors, it has a color profile. I can do operations on it. And then you take the bitmap, create a class of face detector, which is a thing, and then you go, hey, face detector, how many faces are in this image? So let's briefly look at this. And this is all like, you will all see that if you condense this down, it's really only like two lines of code. First, getting the file stream. The storage file, get file from path async, and returned as a storage file, and then you can open it, which gives you the file thing. The crazy part here is that the code, given that C-sharp moved like closer to something that feels, I don't want to say it feels like JavaScript, but it now has var, sort of like C++ now is auto. if you look at demos and you look at example code that Microsoft put up, it's sort of the same code, which is kind of crazy. The only thing that we need to do is because node callbacks, we need to like always do this, right? I'm just gonna remove this from the whole demo code. It's gonna be so much shorter. Okay. Anyway, pretty straightforward, right? We just get the file, and then we get the file. Next up, we go ahead and get the bitmap, which again is sort of like the same concept. We have like this bitmap decoder, and we say, give me a bitmap decoder, which is class, instantiate it, do the operation on it, which is get software bitmap async. You could give it all kinds of parameters, which I haven't done because we don't need to. And then you can go and detect faces on it. In this case, what I've done here is I've made its own method for get face detector for a good reason, because instantiating the face detector takes like 300 milliseconds. So if you want to, for instance, do this in a video, you know, you can totally do that with the same face detector. It's fast enough, but you got to instantiate it once. So again, same pattern, face detector, create async, and then, you know, do the thing with the face detector, which in this case, sorry, the scrolling is terrible, which in this case is just saying detect faces async. Before we do that, though, we take the bitmap and convert it to gray 8, which is grayscale, because apparently, if computers look at humans, they want to see them in grayscale. Otherwise, they don't know what's going on, which I also didn't know. Find that quite fascinating. Looked at OpenCV, which also wants humans in grayscale. So as long as you like have some color in you, you can run away from computers. Seems to work out. So and then I have this super cool sample file right here, which does the whole thing very simply. It's just like, detect faces in this image. And if you found faces, tell me how many you found, right? Sample image is just like a picture I took of a bunch of friends of mine, just like three people. And if we run this, just like fun, right, it does the thing, and it finds three faces. If we go ahead and replace the image with, I don't know, something else, face. No, not Facebook. Oh, God. that was a close one. All right, cool. So we're going with this. I don't know what this is. OK, cool. I don't even. If somebody knows at some point, please somebody explain to me what this is. It's a beauty face expander. I don't know if that means anything to anyone. Oh, man. All right. All right, just name this one.jpg, and we're going to do a different path, one, right? Run this again, one face. There we go. So yeah, no, I mean, it's not really, it's like for Microsoft, I don't care. Well done, Microsoft. A few things to point out. We started building all kinds of stuff using Node.rt, and so I think have a few other people. So whenever you're trying to do anything really cool in Electron that interacts with Windows, maybe just make it a Node module, because then we can all benefit. There's, for instance, something called Electron Windows Notifications, which is how Slack sends you these notifications, which only four of you actually see, because the rest of you are running our Mac notifications, for which there's also a Node module that you can also use. It's just not part of this presentation, so I'm not going to tell you about it until the next meetup. That will be all of it. I got one more slide, which is basically just, if you care about this at all, there is a whole blog post I wrote about this topic just today that contains a little bit more information, a little bit more deep dive into C++ and Windows, and if anybody wants to try this out. And if any of you have any questions about Electron, feel free to reach out to me. Before we close this out, a few things. I'm going to do Q&A after these few things. Number one, this gentleman over here is Bhagav, and he is currently hosting us because he's representing Microsoft, who, you know, own this building and set up all these chairs and give us power and everything. So a quick round of applause for Microsoft. Okay, number two, I keep being very worried about the fact that we keep having these meetups, and we do like somewhat deep dive stuff, and we have a bunch of people showing up who've never used Electron. And I think we all know that Electron is like fairly tough to get into if you've never done any of it. If we were to do like a workshop, like a 3-hour how to Electron, build your first Electron app, just out of the people here, who of you would be interested? Oh God, okay. Oh, well, we need to do that apparently. Okay, second question. Jacob already talked about it, but if there was a conference somewhere in this hemisphere on this coast, would any of you be interested in going? Like just like 8 hours of people building? Yeah, cool. Thank you very much. Yeah, any questions? Yeah, in the back, go for it. So the question was, if I understood you correctly, the question was how we deal with the fact that we would add a bunch of Windows features, but you would still have that code on Mac. Yeah, excellent question. So we, the whole Slack, for instance, is basically one giant React application, and we just use like native features to detect which operating system you're on, and then it's a simple switch if else, right? So in the case of notifications, for instance, we literally have like this block of code where it says, if Windows, require Electron Windows notifications. If Mac, require Electron Mac notifications, and so on and so forth, right? And then there's always the fallback to like something simpler. In the case of notifications, for instance, if like none of those things are existent or didn't load or whatever, we can just use like the native Electron notifications, which have some limitations just because we care more about notifications than, for instance, like a code editor, which makes perfect sense. But that's really how you can do that. It's like pretty straightforward and easy. All you got to do is you got to be sure that you have like clean separation between modules. And the easiest way to do that really is if you look at this thing, which you can actually install and try out, by the way. If you just look at the package.json, we make pretty heavy use of optional packages and the OS field, operating system Win32. So in our code base, you have like a bunch of stuff that is only being installed if the build machine is Windows, a bunch of stuff that is only being installed if the build machine is Mac, and the same, of course, for Linux. But that works out super, super well because if you think about like any given application, there's really only, I want to say, like about 95% of stuff that, there's like 95% of the stuff you could really easily write in HTML and JavaScript and would be just fine. Nobody would notice that the application is not native except for like, you know, checking out memory or something. But it's really only those last 5% that you need to do natively. And for the stuff where we really get the benefit, you know, Nihilus using SQLite or any kind of other fast database, if you ever try to do like a date sort in JavaScript, you literally look at your screen doing nothing for minutes if the database is big enough. So yeah, this works out super well. Yes, please. No, that is actually part of NPM. You can even do like this, and if I just like for fun, NPM install. Well, in theory, it's installing right now. But yeah, it's a native NPM feature, and it will just like be you have the wrong operating system. At least if you install it as a dependency. Oh no, there we go. Cool, unsupported platform. Which is exactly what would happen. And then if this is a module in your dependency tree, you mark it as an optional dependency. So the installation is going to fail, but the installation of your package is going to continue because it was just optional. One thing you have to look out for, which we actually ran into, is if a native dependency fails building, but it's an optional dependency, you will still get a successful build. And then you don't notice until you like run it. But otherwise, yeah. All right, cool. Oh, hey, sorry, in the back. Question was if we share a bunch of code. Yes, we do, like a ton. Yeah. So right now, and I think this is a pretty common concept across applications that do the type of thing that we do, which is that you have instances, you have like clients. We basically have one extremely locked down web view, and we keep putting methods into the web view that the web view can use. So the desktop app is really a version of the browser that gets like a bazillion more APIs to call, right? But at the very core, it's still the same application, which is, you know, difficult to reason about because we have like this thing that we can update every single minute, and then we have this thing which we have to ship out. But it's an excellent way of making your web application very, very powerful by giving it those native APIs. However, given that we have a few newcomers here, doing that type of architecture is definitely for the advanced course, because if not, you basically build a backdoor into every single user's machine. So please don't start with that. This should be like the very last thing you do until, you know, when you're like, oh, I totally know how electron trafficking and electron networking works. Normally at every single meetup, I have this one slide which is like, please don't just like load a website and call this an application, because sooner or later everything will blow up. But yeah. All right. Oh, yeah.
Even now, and the CSS doesn't load it. Totally lost that.
We have actually fixed that, but it's not the first time I hear that. I mean, we have Windows machines.
Right.
Oh, you mean like how the build system is set up?
Yeah. I mean, we build a electron
market. Yeah. I have many feelings about build systems, including our build system. Let me just tell you what I would recommend, because we are constrained by a bunch of stuff. I would recommend, so first thing I would always recommend, just build the Electron application on the target machine. Meaning that if you have a Windows application, build that on Windows. If you have a Mac application, build it on Mac. And if you have a Linux machine, build it on Linux. There's a few ways around it. I think people have like experimented with building Electron apps using Wine, which totally works. But that, to me, just sounds like black magic, and you probably shouldn't try it. Because sooner or later, it's going to blow up in your face, unless you're never doing anything natively. But if you're doing native stuff, you will eventually need Visual Studio. My personal favorite method of building Electron is a combination of Travis CI for Linux and Mac, and AppVeyor for Windows. And we do that for, has anyone ever heard of Ghost? It's a blogging system. Yeah, some nodding. Yeah, few, cool. So I'm part of Ghost Core, which is a nonprofit. We have you know, dramatically less money than Slack, mostly because we have no money. That's sort of how a nonprofit works. But we also are less constrained because nobody's really using Ghost inside their like super, you know, Ghost is not like super critical infrastructure. So that's how we build. We just build on Travis and AppVeyor, and that works beautifully. It's like literally the best thing. Also because AppVeyor does like a kick-ass job of keeping the machines up to date. Same as to be said for Travis. Because once you start managing your own build system, like sooner or later, you'll be like, but I needed the newest Visual Studio, and now I got to sit in front of this machine for 6 hours watching it install. Yeah, cool. One more question. Yeah. Yeah, Kevin, Jacob, do you want to talk about Electron Rebuild and like known and stuff? Because I can give you my feeling and how we handle it, but I think Kevin might be best suited. It's indeed, it is Kevin's fault.
Hey, everybody. So the question was, you know, there's some ABI problems when you build Node modules versus Electron modules. Why is that? Are we doing anything to address that? And what are some of the tools to make it less painful? The reason there is this weird build step that when you have native code, you have to run NPM with these very specific flags and these very specific permutations to get it to build is because the way we ship Node and the way we ship Chromium is slightly different than Node, right? Where Node's release schedule is different than Chrome's release schedule. And so when we release Electron, we have to make sure that the V8 version that we ship with Electron works precisely with the Node version we ship with Electron and the Chrome version we ship with Electron. So Chrome comes out every 6 weeks or so. Node has like 2-year LTS schedules. That V8 version is different all the time and moves all the time. So every so often, they're aligned, and these build problems kind of go away. But then Chrome upgrades to a new V8, and the next Electron build, this you need these flags set again. We would like to make it not something you ever need to worry about. And one way we could do that would be if we or someone else in the community or a company like NPM allowed you to kind of pre-build these modules for the community such that when you install native Electron modules, there's no compilation step necessary. It downloads the pre-built versions. You may have heard of libraries such as Node pre-jip and other libraries that do this. We would love if that was a solution that would make this problem go away, where installation is more consistent, more performant, and less error-prone when these flags kind of shift. The other thing that would possibly change this would be if V8 worked with Chrome and Node a little better to kind of synchronize around when they're going to upgrade the core V8 component, because Node, it depends on what is in those V8 changes and where they are in their LTS schedule. And with Chrome, since they work obviously very closely with the V8 team, they're a little more aggressive in their V8 upgrades. We could also have better tooling. One of the tools that kind of got mentioned as I was walking up here was Electron Rebuild. So there is like an NPM installable application called Electron Rebuild that will kind of re-invoke NPM with the exact flags you need to build your native modules against the version of Electron that you're shipping. And that's a great module that a bunch of people at Slack have worked on that's open source in the community and works for these cases. But I think our end goal would be to make that module obsolete, because that would be the best case for everybody, where you just run NPM install, it works every time, just like as if you're running it in Node, it would work in Electron. And that's definitely where we want to get. And hopefully in 2017, perhaps, would be great.
Cool. Did that answer your question? Okay. Just so that everybody else can benefit from this like super detailed and very great answer, the core issue, if you never had to deal with this, is if you just run npm install and it's a native module, then npm will go ahead and be like, all right, you're running this version of Node. Let me quickly compile everything you need against this version of Node. And usually, if you have a native module, this is one of mine, you have like this include v8 up there, the header files, and node.h. The trouble here is now that you then npm then goes ahead and compiles your native module, assuming that it will talk to Node. However, it will not talk to Node. It will talk to Electron, which has a different version of v8, and the header files will be different. So as soon as you require the module, Electron will be like, eh, this is not a thing I understand. Please help. And really, all we need to do as a community is get to a point where if you run npm install and it's an Electron project, npm is like, this will probably not be run inside Node, but inside Electron. And there are a few talks on how to do that, but it's pretty hard, mostly, right?
One other thing, could you pull up the Electron issues?
Yes.
We do have an Electron issue about this where we're working with some people from the Node core team, and just filter on discussions in the labels, on the labels. Oh, yeah. Wow. Anyway, yeah. Keep going. Did we go by it? There is a issue somewhere. I thought it was labeled discussion. Maybe just search for V8. But there's an issue where it kind of talks about where we can get to and how we can kind of allow native module author developers to not be dragged into this. Yes, that one. Oh, blocked. Yeah. So it's a good discussion, though. It's got 64 comments for you to read at your leisure. But it's a good one because this kind of lays it out. You see some high-profile Node people. You see some high-profile Slack people in here. So we're going to get there. It's just a matter of time and tooling.
Cool. So I think, unless there are any other questions, this basically concludes the scheduled part of this meetup. I think we can all like just hang out for another 15 minutes, annoy the GitHub folks, maybe. Otherwise, thank you all for coming, or don't annoy them. But you know.
It's not annoying.
Oh yeah, no, it's true.
Yeah,
go for it.
Something exciting that's coming up. We're gonna ship Chrome 54 support in Electron. Let's say next week.
Wow,
it's been a long time coming, and just to give a little background for people that don't know, Chrome switched their build systems in Chrome 54, and so we had to port a massive amount of Electron's build system to adapt to Chrome's rewritten build system. But Chrome 54 will be out, and we'll quickly go to 55 after that, if you're aware. I think we're already at Chrome 57 in Canary, so we're trying to accelerate back up. This 54 release took a while, but I think we're going to release it sometime next week.
Cool. Thank you, Kevin.
Which is also really freaking cool, because if you have followed Chrome 55, that thing has a bunch of really amazing stuff, like native async await.
Yeah. Yeah. 55. Yes. Yes, sir. And then, of course, we get WASM and all this cool stuff. Anyway, thank you all for coming. This is pretty much it. We're probably going to do this again, right? Maybe. Who knows? Yeah. Thank you.